So what kind of generalizations? One could go on and on with individuals here, but they're all, obviously they're not all ex-slaves, and even the ex-slaves are not just right off the plantation fields. Many of them were actually better educated than their white counterparts in public office there. But as I say, you get down to local levels, the people I haven't really been talking about, supervisors, aldermen, education officials, they tended to be former slaves, but again, teachers very often, ministers, and people like that. Now, this local black political leadership emerged with amazing rapidity right after the Civil War, and in a few places during the war where the Union Army was occupying. There were these black conventions, 1865, 66, and then in 1867, the real explosion of black politics when the right to vote is granted. You get just a tremendous proliferation of public political organizing throughout the black belt. Most of the organizing before that had been in major cities, but now out in the countryside where the vast majority actually live. Here's an image. This is just a lithograph from Harper's Weekly of a little political meeting somewhere. You got a guy on the right just speaking to a bunch of people sitting on a bench. This is not actually all that different. If you remember back to the very first week, the painting of grassroots democracy in action that I showed, with a guy standing before a little crowd and giving a speech, stump speaking. This is the same thing, except all these people are African Americans. So it's different in that regard. And also interesting, unlike that other one, if one looks carefully, these are women sitting up here on the porch. The men are down here, he's addressing the men, but women are listening to this speech. Women cannot vote, women cannot hold public office, with the exception of postmistress. There were black women postmistresses appointed in some parts of the South in Reconstruction, but they can't hold elective office, they can't be delegates to Republican Party conventions, but women take part in political organizing. They express their views, they take part in meetings like this, they take part in political parades, they wear buttons. There was one memoir I read where a woman in Mississippi, white woman, is complaining that all the women working in her house are wearing little Grant for President buttons in 1868. You know, this is their form of political expression. So you get a sense in the Janap book is the resolutions or a statement of a political convention, a black political convention in Alabama. And you can read it and see what their demands are. But what's very interesting is not just the specific demands, but the insistent voice of that document, the absolute forthright demand for complete equality. There's no beating about the bush. They're not shy, they're not reticent, they're not violent, they're not threatening, but their language is absolutely forthright. We want all the rights that are enjoyed by white people. That's what freedom means. That's what equality means now. Now, the emergence of black politics here is one part of a bigger process going on, which is, I would say, the creation of the modern black community. Now, of course, there had been black communities beforehand, free blacks in the North, South, slave communities, but now the modern black, the infrastructure, the organizational community, which couldn't fully exist before the Civil War, emerges in Reconstruction. Studies of local cities in the South, like Memphis, like Mobile, et cetera, show this tremendous emergence of local organizations, drama societies, benevolent associations, literary clubs, all sorts of things just springing up out of nowhere. And of course, the centerpiece of this community life is the black church. And as I mentioned before, one of the key changes taking place here is the separation of the religious life of black and white Southerners. Before the Civil War, there was the so-called invisible institution, the slave religious, not really an organization, but slave religious practices or services, often very secret, Nat Turner was a slave preacher. Often these things took place in the woods or some hidden place where they would have their own. And then very often the owner would bring a white preacher onto plantations to spread a different kind of Christianity. The white Christianity was based on servitude, service. The black Christianity was based on Exodus, on the Exodus story of the Bible, and the promise eventually of freedom. Then there were churches that free blacks and sometimes slaves attended in cities, but these were biracial churches with white ministers where African Americans could worship, but usually they had to sit in the back or in the, you know, second level upstairs, and they didn't control the organization in any way. Well, the independent church emerges in Reconstruction. Very quickly, blacks just withdraw from these white-dominated churches. They build their own. Within a few years, there's almost no African-Americans in these white-dominated churches anymore. The Methodist Church, the Baptist Church particularly, by 1876, there were 500,000 people in black Baptist churches in the South. The Baptists become by far the largest denomination because, for complicated reasons, it's very easy to start a Baptist church. You don't need a lot of education. I mean, you don't need to be ordained by some larger group like in the Presbyterians or something. Anybody can set up a Baptist church and usually does. And then they split and another church is set up. So it's very easy to do, and these emerge all over the place. Methodist Church, black ministers from the North come down and try to establish these churches. And black preachers, as we said, go into politics. They become major political leaders. And more to the point, the church becomes a center of everything. It becomes a political organizing center. It becomes a social center. It becomes a center for schools and education. It becomes a place for communities to police themselves. Churches actually they monitor the behavior of their own members. And especially if you don't trust the official judicial system, people will bring divorce cases or even cases of children being obstreperous and all this to the church, not to local judges when they don't necessarily trust them. And religious language sort of suffuses black politics. That's one of the things. If you read these people, when I was doing research, it's a long time ago, one of the more interesting documents I came across, this is just a Xerox, Address to the Colored People of North Carolina. Okay, see that? 1870. Signed by about a dozen or so African-American members of the legislature of North Carolina. This is about a controversy with Governor Holden, the Republican. The Democrats are trying to impeach him. And this is direct. It says, to the colored people throughout the state. Okay, so what do they say? They say, look, we elected Governor Holden, and now the Democrats are trying to get rid of him. Governor Holden's been doing a good job. No, that's not what they say. Here's how they start. Know ye that since the time of Haman, that the time that Haman conspired to destroy all the Jews who dealt in the Persian dominions because he hated Mordecai, no wickedness has been devised that will bear comparison with the measures in the present. In other words, they don't start with what's going on now. They start with Mordecai and Haman. Now, you know, I'm a fairly secular type. I never heard of Mordecai and Haman, personally. But they are, we live in a secular age. Religion is very important in our politics today. People use that language, but I don't think you would hear it exactly like this. But the point is, they assume that ordinary black people know what they are talking about, right? That people are not going to pick them and say, what in the world is this about? No, they know what it's about. So the Bible is something that you can refer to, you see, for political purposes. It's a language that enables you to make analogies and to enable people to understand what you are trying to tell them about what's going on. Now, one other thing before, I want to get to these carpetbaggers in a minute, but one other thing that scholars of Reconstruction of late, and going back 20, 30 years, have been emphasizing is divisions among these black office holders. We should not say that, you know, they were not like any group of politicians. They had different ideas, some of them. They fought among themselves. They didn't all agree on everything. They were not totally homogenous. One line of division, there are two kinds of line of division which overlap. One is the former free and the former slave. And another one is those who are better off economically versus those who are not. Now, often there's a lot of overlap. The free blacks tend to be better off than the former slaves, generally speaking. And the argument was developed, particularly originally by the historian Thomas Holt and picked up by others, that one of the reasons for the failure to distribute land was not just Congress, not just Andrew Johnson, but that the black political leadership, at least the free part, the better off part, was not in favor of that. They held this free labor idea that you should work your way up, particularly black carpetbaggers from the North. He did an analysis of the legislature in South Carolina, and he argued that those who were better off, those who had been free before the war, those who came from the North, were rather conservative on economic issues and tended to emphasize much more things that we would like call civil rights, integration, public accommodations, and not pay much attention to the economic plight or economic demands of ordinary former slaves. I think this might be, it's an interesting argument, and I think it certainly has the merit that saying that race is not the only factor here. There are class factors, there are factors in background that affect how people act. So, you know, one can decide whether this makes perfect sense or not. I think there are counter arguments. For example, Mississippi, which had almost no free blacks and almost all the black political leaders were former slaves, also did even less than South Carolina on the land issue. South Carolina, we'll see this next time, actually set up a land commission to try to redistribute land. So I'm not sure this argument totally holds water, but I think one of the points that you can see in the Janap book, there's another document by a black member of Congress, I can't remember which one, Kane maybe, about the kind of insults and degrading treatment he receives trying to get to Washington. You know, he can't find a hotel, he can't get on a train, he can't get a meal. So one can see why these public officials do emphasize issues like social equality in the public sphere, because they, you know, your average guy in a plantation is not worried about whether he can get in a hotel or not. But these political office holders are subject to a lot of demeaning prejudices, which white office holders obviously don't suffer.